Well, hello everyone. Great to have you here today, and thank you for tuning in and making time to be with us. Just to let you know, everyone, that today's webinar will be recorded. And first, I want to introduce our CX for Growth webinar series. So we've been doing these monthly from the startups team here at Intercom, joined by special guests each month, and really focus on different customer experience topics to help drive growth in your business. Grab a coffee, settle in today. Hopefully, it'll be, you know, an educational and helpful conversation for you. I'm delighted to be joined by Aneto from Chatdesk. And today's topic, we're going to focus in on leveraging social media to grow engagement in your business. We're looking at the foundations of social moderation and conversation, how to respond to customers on social effectively, and then using social to strengthen your relationships and drive conversions. Excuse me. Let me first introduce myself, and then Aneto, I'll ask you to introduce yourself as well. So I'm Alan McGlinchey. I work on the startups team here at Intercom, and working with VC firms and founders globally to position Intercom in the startup ecosystem. So Aneto, I'd like to let you introduce yourself, please.
Hi, thanks for having us here, Alan, and hello everyone on the call. I'm Aneto, CEO and co-founder of Chatdesk. We are an Intercom partner, and brands like Olaplex and BarkBox and Thinks work with us to help them drive conversions on social media and also to scale their support efficiently.
Thanks, Aneto. It'd be great to maybe just tell us a bit about the foundation and why you went about starting Chatdesk.
Yeah, definitely. I started Chatdesk 6 years ago with my co-founder, Andrew. We both wanted to use our skills to create greater impact in the world. Specifically, we want to decrease the wealth gap. A lot of people need income, a lot of people need jobs. And we saw an opportunity to create jobs in the customer service space specifically, because you know customer service employs lots of people. And the way we do it is that many brands receive a lot of messages from their customers, but they don't have enough support agents to respond to the messages. So Chatdesk helps them hire, train, and manage the agents so it's easy for them to scale their support. Particularly for times like weekends or after hours or peak times. And one thing that's very different is they only pay for the tickets that are solved. And so by helping brands with this, we're actually creating millions of flexible remote job opportunities for people.
That's really interesting. I suppose in a way you're able to break down the tasks into very small amounts of time that probably provide even more flexibility for people or you know, the agents that you're bringing on, right?
Exactly.
Nice. That's cool. Well, I suppose, you know, just interested to dig into the experience of you and your co-founder. Like, did you work together in the past, or, you know, what was that kind of connection, or how did that come about?
Yeah, definitely. We actually got connected by a mutual friend. We had worked for the same company. We both worked as consultants at a place called McKinsey. We both kind of shared this mission around creating income, creating jobs, helping to close the wealth gap. And that's how we got connected and started working together.
Oh, cool. That's always nice to hear. I suppose that just like moving on to kind of the topics of how to set up a foundation for social moderation and conversation, like at what stage should companies start focusing on social moderation in their evolution?
Well, when the company starts running ads on social media, that's a great time to start moderating your social comments and your DMs. The first reason is that it's a guaranteed and easy way to help drive up your conversion from those social campaigns. You know, the reason why you're running ads is because you want to acquire customers for your brand, for your business. And what we find from our customers is when an end user, when a consumer sees your ad, they're going to comment or DM on the post. And we found around 50% of these comments or DMs are opportunities for conversion. They're pre-sale types of questions. People are asking a product question, you know, like, do you have this in a particular size or in a particular color? And for those 50% of people that ask the question, that's you know, a pre-sale opportunity, around 10% of those will end up converting. So that's the main reason. It's just that you're sitting on a gold mine of all these comments, all these DMs that are coming in, and just by responding to them, you're gonna get customers to convert. The second reason to really focus on this is around brand reputation. Some of the comments that come in, unfortunately, are a bit negative or a bit cynical. People say things like, oh, I can get this cheaper from some other company, right? Yeah. And you want to address that. You want to respond to it in a branded way and say why your product is valuable, right? Or you want to hide it because other customers are seeing that. And when they see a response, that helps them build trust in the brand. Or, you know, if it's something negative or cynical, if you hide it, that also, you know, increases the efficacy of your ads.
Yeah, I saw an example the other day of, I think it was one of the Collisons responding directly to a customer on Twitter who was having an issue, and they responded, you know, the CEO directly responded within a short amount of time and directed them to resolve the issue, and the person tweeted how happy they were with the support. And I just thought it was such an extreme example. You know, obviously they're a huge company and things like that, but such an extreme but strong example of how to react and turn a bad social, you know, comment into a resolved and happy customer, you know?
Yeah, that's a great example. I think even when it's a bad situation, first of all, responding quickly, that already makes people feel better, right? Because exactly. Why are they commenting? Because they want to be heard. They actually have a real question or real issue. And so just responding quickly is the key.
Yeah, no, super. And I suppose consumer facing is obvious, right? But like e-commerce, direct to consumer, those type of industries, where else have you seen it being done right? I suppose I just use an example of a payments company, which is probably not as consumer facing, but where else have you seen it being done right by
companies? I believe every brand can be successful on social media. I'll give you some examples. You know, one of the brands we work with is an e-learning company called Quantic. They deliver an online MBA program. Another company we work with is a ski resort, right? You know, social media is pervasive. We're all on it.
Yeah.
All demographics of all age ranges. It's just a great way for customers to discover brands that exactly match their interests. And that's why it's unique and so powerful in our society.
Yeah, sure. Actually, in my own life, I know when I follow a couple of ski resorts up in Tahoe, and I know the snow is good. It's time to get up there when I see posts starting to surface in, you know, December to February or whenever the snow might arrive, right? So it is really powerful. What are the basic building blocks for companies as they're getting started on building out their moderation?
Yeah, definitely. First, there's three things. First is process. Mm-hmm. Tools and your team. So starting with process, you want to put together some sample scripts based on your brand voice and some guidelines, right? At Chatdesk, we actually offer a free resource on our website that you can grab that has 24 different templates for different scenarios. So order status or refund or cancellation, you know, how can you respond to all those different scenarios? So once you get those templates down, you're ready for those types of scenarios when they occur. The second part is the tools. You need a tool to do the social moderation. For example, you could use Intercom for responding to your social DMs. And that's a great way to get started. And I know you guys have a great startup package that makes it free for many months. So definitely check that out. And the third part is your team. You need to select some members of your team who are going to be responding. Maybe if you're Stripe and you're the CEO, you're going to be one of those people. But it's actually very natural for the co-founders of a company, especially in the early days, to be responding on social media. It's very authentic.
Yeah. And I suppose building that out as you scale as well, you probably want them also to be responsive, or at least the issues that are heading towards CEOs and founders, that they're being addressed by your team members as well, on social platforms and not being left behind. I suppose, how do you, you know, if we kind of move on to how to respond to customers on social effectively, like how are you seeing customers organizing their teams effectively around it? So is it mainly a CS type effort, or how do you see them building out that function?
Yeah, it differs based on the size of the company. For a smaller brand, the most common tactic is what I've described, you know, one of the founders actually managing social media directly. This is actually a great idea in the beginning because you can see the questions and issues in real time, and you can ensure that the responses are matching the brand voice. So we actually recommend that for the leaders of the company to be out there on social media in the beginning. But as the company scales, you start to see a lot of repetition of the issues and the questions. Maybe you want to bring in an intern, typically someone under the marketing team, and then any customer support related issues can get escalated to the person who can actually solve those. And then finally, you know, as you grow, you know, it's tough to cover all these different channels. There's Facebook, there's Instagram, there's Twitter, there's TikTok, and many more. So it's tough to cover all these channels 24/7. That's where a tool like Chatdesk comes in, where we can provide you with agents who are actually industry experts. So for example, if you're a beauty brand or a fashion brand, we'll find someone who has a deep interest or expertise in that space. When you get to even larger brands, you know, you have so much volume, then you can have a dedicated social media team. But even in this scenario, it's difficult to keep up. You know, some of the brands we work with get thousands of comments on each post.
Yeah.
They just keep coming in. So even when you have a dedicated team across all these channels, it's tough to keep up.
And do you see periods of peak? So like, let's say in an e-commerce example, coming into the holiday season, there's just going to be more demand, right? Because there's more purchases happening. Do you see your type of services addressing those type of peaks and troughs in a much better manner?
Yeah, certainly. I'll give you an example. Like one of the brands we work with is Olaplex, which is a leading hair care brand. Mm-hmm. And they had an issue on social media, which kind of erupted about a particular ingredient. People had a lot of questions about this ingredient and whether it was safe, for example, for pregnancy. So they just got flooded with comments and they got flooded with emails. And they used Chatdesk to make sure that they were giving a fast and personalized response to every customer to address the issue. Ended up becoming a non-issue. There was no actual problem with their ingredients. But you know, this is how things can flame up on social media. So for those types of peak situations, both planned, like Black Friday, Cyber Monday, the holiday shopping season, you know, a product launch, and also unplanned things which happen, it's a great way to scale up your team very quickly and very efficiently.
Super. And how globally dispersed is your team? Is it predominantly across North America, or is it further afield as well?
Yeah, the majority of people who work on the platform, the support agents, we call them Chatdesk experts, are US-based. But we do support customers in other languages and other countries. Olaplex, just using the example again, they use Chatdesk also for the Italian market because they were launching there. So they have Italian-speaking agents based in Italy working on the platform.
Oh, nice. And time zone-wise, do people just, I suppose most people are reacting to the time zone they're in as well. Is probably
exactly. And that's one of the benefits, you know, now that, you know, you can hire anywhere, we can actually have people across the US, you know, on the East Coast, on the West Coast, Hawaii, Alaska. We're able to cover a lot of those late night hours with you know, people working from different parts of the world.
Yeah. And how many of your experts do you think, is this kind of, you know, just a part-time gig that they're doing, or are they doing this with a combination of other kind of part-time gigs, or is it a whole mixture? What are you seeing from
The majority of them are working part-time. To tell you a bit about the demographics, it's actually majority women. Okay. And it's a lot of stay-at-home parents, military spouses. I think that the reason why that's happening, it's not that we targeted that demographic specifically, is that, you know, the traditional workforce where you have an 8-hour day, whether you're at a desk or you're in, you know, a retail location or a factory or something, you know, requires you to have that block of time. But if you're a parent, you know, you have this strange society we've created where, you know, kids go to daycare or kids go to school. It ends at 3, and then someone has to pick them up. So this type of work that, you know, you can jump into the platform anytime and respond to some messages appeals to people who are, for example, parents and need just like 2 hours or 3 hours type of work, not something that requires 8 hours of a day.
Makes a lot of sense. What are the big trends you're seeing at the moment from kind of the platform side and social?
Yeah, the first, which I think a lot of brands are feeling, is just the increasing cost of social media advertising due to increased competition. There are just more and more brands in social media who are advertising, and that's driving up the cost. The second one, which is more recent, is just, you know, decreasing effectiveness. Some of the privacy changes that Apple rolled out on iOS last year are kind of leading up to that. And then I think on the positive side, there's some new greenfield opportunities on newer platforms like TikTok and Reddit. Whenever there's a new platform, there's less competition, which means the costs are lower and you as a brand can stand out easier.
Yeah, and there's more unique ways to stand out probably as well than had been. And you know, I suppose thinking about those costs, like it probably makes a huge amount of sense to be focusing on the conversion from the activity you have than driving more money into, you know, your pay-per-click or whatever kind of focus you have, right? So that makes a lot of sense where your team's stepping into that, right?
Yeah, that's the kind of exactly the way we think about it. Like a lot of brands spend tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands on ads, which is great. But then you get all these comments and all these messages, and then a lot of brands don't respond to those. And it's actually very low cost. You know, our pricing starts at $99 a month, actually, to make sure you give responses to all your customers. So why shouldn't you, you know, great, spend a lot of money on ads and then spend a little bit of money to make sure that the customers who have questions get answers to them.
Yeah, that's super. It'd be great to hear some examples of customers who've really managed that scale well on social platforms. Maybe one example that comes to mind, you know?
Yeah, definitely. One brand I really like is called Storyworth. It's a product that helps you create a book or a memoir with stories from a loved one, like a grandparent or a parent. I actually use this product with my mother. Oh, nice. For her 70th birthday, I gave her a book of all the stories she wrote. And they recently launched a series of posts where they ask their customers to share their favorite traits of their mother. For example, like, how similar are you to your mother? And I've really been impressed by how many people are sharing a lot of heartwarming stories, and they're getting thousands of comments on these posts. And it's helping people share, but it's also helping people engage with the brand, which is good for the company. And so that's really just an amazing way to use social media to help people share stories. And it's quite powerful. And Father's Day weekend is this weekend in the US. So if you're looking for a gift for your father, you can check out Storyworth.com.
Storyworth. That's always good to see.
Yeah. One other example I'll share is Thinks. They're a clothing and underwear brand. They were recently acquired by Kimberly-Clark. They're the makers of Kleenex and Huggies and many other brands. And they're very active on Facebook and Instagram and Twitter and TikTok. They run a lot of ads, and they use chat desk to help address a lot of those questions or comments and negative comments sometimes that they receive.
Yeah, oh, super. I suppose moving on to kind of using social media to strengthen your relationships and drive conversions, you know, how do you optimize for your customer's experience and make sure that it's a smooth and enjoyable experience on their side, right?
Yeah, I think I mentioned this already. The first one is just to respond as fast as possible. There's a study that came out from Twitter a while back that shows that when a brand responds to a customer's tweet in less than 6 minutes, the customer is willing to pay almost $20 more for that brand in the future. So they actually were able to quantify fast responses drives more revenue for your brand. The second recommendation is just to be as personalized as possible. Chatbots have a role to play. And I know Intercom has a very strong chatbot offering, but it's mostly more for private channels like your DMs or your emails. On social media, it's public. And so you want to reply in a as personalized a way as possible. And the final part is just showing empathy. Sometimes when customers reach out on social media, they've already tried to email you or call you, right? Yeah. And so they're getting desperate, they're getting anxious, and that's why they're going to this channel. So just realizing that there's some frustration that might be behind this, particularly for negative questions, you want to be able to treat each customer carefully and with empathy so that the interaction doesn't go the wrong way and go viral in that way.
Yeah. And you have to be careful of those different viral spreads. And I think even with our kind of chatbot or advice around building out your different automations is don't pretend not to be a machine, make sure that the person knows that they're either talking to an automated system or that they're moving then to a human at some point, and make it as personal and personalized as possible for that individual is super important. I suppose, what combination of tools are you seeing? And maybe take me through just maybe at the earlier stage and then maybe up through the scales of businesses, what kind of combination of tools are you seeing companies using?
Yeah, so you need a tool to manage your DMs. Intercom is a great option for that. Or you can use the native applications that are provided by the Facebooks and the Twitters of this world. And that's how most people usually start. We use all these products as consumers, so it's very natural for you to use it as a business. But as your volume grows, you probably need a partner, maybe someone like Chatdesk, to make sure you're giving fast and personalized responses 24/7. We also have a free analytics tool. Analytics is something that's important just to know, like, what is the sentiment of those conversations? What are people talking about on those channels? Because those can give you ideas for your products, ideas for your content, feedback on how to change your ads to make them more effective. So you want to probably have an analytics or insights tool as well to do social listening. And we provide a free version of that at Chatdesk.
Nice. And have you seen the space has probably got much more crowded in all the tools that are out there? Like, are you seeing more and more tools out there, or are you starting to see companies kind of bring them together in a more consolidated view?
Yeah, I actually think there was a lot of tools right around 2016, which is around the time we got started, but it's actually kind of cooled. I think since then, what you've seen is like the tools get a lot more sophisticated. Just to use the example from Intercom, I know you guys launched a new inbox recently and you launched a lot of new functionality. So I think that's the pattern we've seen is a lot of the tools that started off pretty simple have a lot more functionality. You're getting more value for what you're spending on these tools.
They're going much deeper and integrating better and playing to get playing together better with the other tools, I think is what definitely the trend and the movement we're seeing. What predictions do you have for the year ahead, right? There's obviously, you know, there's a lot of new platforms, a lot of noise, and a lot of people are using social. There's tons of apps on my own phone. I know, it's just an example. So what do you see in the year ahead for businesses as they're looking at the social media
landscape? One topic that's not specific to social media, but is on everyone's mind, is just the economy. You know, is it a recession? Is it not a recession? I'm not the right person to ask that. I think it's a bit too early to tell how it's going to evolve. But social media is going to continue to grow and be an important acquisition channel for brands, because it's just the most cost efficient and most direct way to acquire customers, that's so targeted, the kind of customers you can reach. So I don't expect, you know, social media spending or social media advertising, social media moderation to slow down. Actually going to continue to increase. A specific trend that you probably already know about is just the rise of influencers and the creator economy. So even if your brand doesn't have a large presence on social media, you can align yourself with an influencer who reaches your target demographic, and they can help you get the word out about your brand. I know, you know, just an example, like my wife just follows a lot of these different influencers and creators. And every time she has a new product in the house, I'm like, which influencer did you learn about that from? And usually there's someone that she follows who talked about it. So another example, one of the brands we work with is a swimwear brand, you know, and they've had a great, great success working with influencers. And you know, the influencer might showcase the products or just talk about the value of the products. And that's actually very timely, you know, because we're heading into beach season now for swimwear brands.
I think I'm getting a sense that kind of influencer piece is going to be more pervasive across into different parts of B2B tech, as well as, you know, the traditional e-commerce and product service places that you might expect it. Are you getting a sense of that as well, the kind of scaling beyond sectors and much wider into the economy?
Yeah, I agree. I think it's just so powerful in terms of how targeted you can get about the demographic and how personal like the message is. Would you rather hear like a branded, you know, highly produced ad, or would you rather hear like a human being who you trust and you follow, like talking about a product? So yes, it started in the consumer kind of e-commerce world, but it is likely to go into B2B brands also.
Yeah, oh, super. Yeah. And then I suppose just kind of advice for people on here today getting started and listening in their business, like where do you think they should start out? You mentioned a couple of resources, sounds super. Any other guidance you have?
Yeah, so we provide, as I mentioned, you know, some resources on our site for scripts or, you know, responses you can use for your customers. That's one great way to start. I think another way is just to get in there. Like you probably are running ads at the moment and you see the comments and DMs. So either you yourself, if you're the owner of the business, or just assign someone to your team to stay on top of it. Obviously, you can use a tool like Chatdesk, and it's free to get started with us as well. And then there's tools like Intercom, which have a free plan, which you can get started with.
Oh, super. I suppose I might just head towards Q&A here. Just to get started on it, TikTok is becoming one of the most popular platforms out there. And I believe the engagement rates on it are huge in comparison to some of the other platforms. So how are brands taking advantage of the diverse demographics on TikTok to target customers and really drive sales?
Yeah, I'm very excited about TikTok. It's the most downloaded app in the US since Q1 2021. So if you don't have TikTok on your phone, you probably should check it out. It's a green field for brands. The cost of advertising is so much lower because many brands are not yet there. And the ones that are there are still formulating their strategy.
We lost you there for a second, Nada.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, you're back. All good.
Okay, cool. And the majority of advertising on TikTok is through influencers. You need to find these influencers who match your target demographic, and then you can reach out to them to help them create content for your brand. So she had a personal example. A friend of mine, she actually has a TikTok where she makes cooking videos for Vietnamese recipes. See, very specific demographic. Her account is Tao Chow's, if you want to check it out. And one of her videos went viral. It had over 120,000 views. So if you were a food brand and you wanted to reach her followers, you could reach out to her and ask her to post about your brand. She might even do it for free just because you have a cool brand. Yeah. And so that's really like the main use case. Another use case from a large brand we work with is called Shea Moisture. It's a leading hair care brand, and they use Chatdesk to do what we call proactive social engagement. What we did is we identified some hashtags that are very relevant for them on TikTok. So hashtag natural hair, which has 8 billion views, or hashtag curly hair, which has 18 billion views. And those are essentially communities of people who are using those hashtags, and they use chat desk to reach out to those communities.
Well, super. How do you identify those hashtags? Is it pretty intuitive within TikTok's kind of suite of tools, or do you have any other kind of way of
doing it? Yeah, you can just browse it as a consumer. And a lot of times you as a brand, you know those hashtags because you're using them yourself, right? To tag your content. And they also show you similar hashtags that other people are using. So just browse around different content on hashtag on TikTok, because TikTok's an interest-based network, very similar to Twitter, not a friend-based network. Sure. So that's why people are using these hashtags, because they want to show their interest and link their content to other content that's similar.
Yeah. Oh, super. I see one question here. One of our guests is looking for the name of the company you mentioned for Father's Day about the book. Was it
Storyworth? Storyworth.com.
Okay, very good. Thanks for sharing that. I suppose just, you know, do you think as companies are getting going, should they focus on multiple platforms? Should they focus on one? Does it depend on their industry or their space? What's the best kind of advice you have for folks there?
Exactly what you said. It depends on your industry. It's better to focus on the channels where your customers are, right? So if your customers, for example, are startups or startup leaders, maybe Twitter is a better channel, because a lot of startups and venture capitalists and those type of folks are on Twitter.
Yeah.
Right. But if your target demographic is Gen Z, then you probably want to look at TikTok. And so on. So you don't have to do all channels. There's so many channels. Maybe you're a gaming company, and then maybe like Twitch is your channel, or Discord or Reddit. So you know like where your customers are, and that's the channel you should probably focus on.
Yeah, that's super. I see one question here from what are the biggest mistakes, waste of time when companies are trying to grow their social media presence or on platforms?
Yeah, so I think you said what's one of the biggest mistakes.
What are some of the biggest mistakes you've seen kind of companies make when they're trying
to grow? I've seen people try to grow their brand in an inauthentic way. So there are ways to, for example, like buy likes or buy engagement. And sure. I think consumers can discern when it looks like things are fake. And so I think that's kind of wasted effort and wasted money, like trying to fake engagement or fake that you have a hard following or like a lot of likes, and it's not really necessary.
Yeah.
I think this, you know, being authentic and showing your founder or your products, your company, and talking about your journey, like that's what today's society and today's social media wants to see. I talked about like the highly produced is another mistake I see brands make. Like, you know, I've seen the statistics ourselves, you know, when we make content, let's say for LinkedIn, because we're a B2B brand. Yeah. The content that looks like someone who's just talking to the camera, just like you and I are talking, actually gets more engagement than like a highly produced, expensive video that we made.
Yeah.
So people are looking for real connection and real stories. They're not looking for something that's highly produced.
Yeah. And that probably goes into why we're seeing platforms like TikTok, which are these kind of not overly produced in the moment live stories that you're seeing going really viral, along with the algorithm, I'm sure, as well. But no, super. Is there any last questions from the audience, or anything you'd like to leave them with before I close out? I don't see any here.
Just I think what I leave people with is you're sitting on a gold mine. Like your social media comments, your social media messages, you can drive real conversions and that are trackable when you just respond to those customers. So if you have the time, you know, you can do it yourself, or you can hire an intern or hire a customer support team. And even when you have a team, we found that companies are missing out because there's just so many comments for those large brands. So again, you could use a platform like ChatDesk, but just don't miss out on this gold mine of all these social media messages and comments that come in, that when you respond to them, you can drive conversions.
Yeah, that's super. And I think with the economy we're potentially coming into, driving conversions is going to be critical for lots of businesses on an ongoing basis. So we'll take this last question and I'll close out, but the best way to manage kind of content creation and the best platforms to plan that out?
Yeah, certainly. There are many different platforms. I don't want to be partial to any particular platforms, but you can look at things like Sprout Social or Hootsuite, and they're, you know, larger ones as well, like your Sprinklers, your Spark Centrals for larger brands. But I think you can find many different tools. I think some of the native tools, even like Facebook itself, offers tools if you're using Facebook to plan out your content and post and schedule your content. So depends on your budget, depends on the sophistication you need. So you could just start with using the Facebook itself, or you can move to one of those paid or more expensive tools.
Oh, super. Thanks, Ned. I'll just, first of all, thank you to our guests for joining us today. Check out Chatdesk. We'll follow up with an email with some information about them. But really, if you're looking to scale your customer support efficiently, it sounds like there's a ton of resources as well if you're just getting started for earlier stage startups. So please do get in touch with Neto and his team. First of all, thank you to our guests for joining us today. Check out Chatdesk. We'll follow up with any startups program available on our website. We have over 5,000 startups using us, so please go check that out. If you're SMEs and mid-market companies, you know, if you'd like to learn more, please check out our website as well, or ping a note in the messenger on our homepage. Thank you for joining today. Our next session will be on, I think, July 20th with Localize and Linktree. We'll be talking about localization, so really look forward to that. So Neto, thank you very much for joining us today. I really appreciated the conversation. Thank you. Your time. Thank you to everyone, and have a great day, and take care. Okay.
Thank you, everyone.
Cheers. Bye.